We shall not capitulate to the demands of these grasping Xenos, brothers! This ground holds one of our own. A hero whose bravery we shall not betray with defeat. We will defend his honor. We defend our chapter's honor to the last drop of blood.
The Emperor's Angels of Death are the single most revered fighting force amongst the stars. Molded in the image of their Primarchs, and epitomizing their most cherished attributes such as valor, honor, and duty, their deeds made in the name of the Imperium are the stuff of legends. Yet among all chapters of the Adeptus Astartes, one above all has earned a reputation as the greatest of their number, and such a prestigious force of warriors requires a leader of unmatched tactical and martial acumen. For today, we shall elucidate a chapter master of the Space Marines, not only responsible for leading his own men, but the governance of an empire of Imperial space. The venerated Lord of Macragge, Marneus Calgar. Though many of the masters of the Adeptus Astartes hail from bloodlines of nobility and families proud of their forebears' military service, not all are hewn from the monuments of storied, historical giants. Born on the world of Nova Fulium, the boy known as Tacitan served the noble house of Calgar as a labor serf. Though not of noble birth, the young attendant shared a bond of immense friendship with his lord, Marneus. The house of Calgar sought to offer their promising heir as an aspirant of the Ultramarines, for such a position as a warrior king of Ultramar promised honor and glory to their family name. Beseeching his father to pay for the tutoring of not only himself, but his compatriots, Cato, Severin, and Tacitan, Marneus and his companions sought to escape the monotony of their birthworld. Trained by the failed aspirant of the chapter, Crixus, this bitter yet capable killer knew all too well the trials that lay ahead for these naive children. Traveling to the neighboring desolate planet of Fulium Minor, the beasts of this feral mirror of the boys' homeworld proved invaluable in testing their survival instincts. More initiates joined their number, only to be slain soon after, yet the four boys of Nova Fulium proved worthy of succeeding in the trials of Crixus. Yet on the eve of their dispatch to the Ultramarines for further training, Tacitan and Marneus awoke to find their compatriots missing. Investigating a cavern forbidden by Crixus to enter, the tracks of their friends led Tacitan and Marneus into the depths of a long-dormant wreckage of a Wordbearer's voidcraft. Within the darkest depths of the vessel, the boys discovered a shrine dedicated to the blood god, Khorne, surrounded by the aspirants they had once called brothers. Following years of thankless toil as a recruiter for the Ultramarines, Crixus had listened to the whispers of his patron of Chaos, and sought to sacrifice these boys on the altar of Khorne to achieve his own ascension as a true servant of the Blood God. Discovered by the Khornate worshippers, Tacitan and Marneus attempted to escape the blades of their enemies, yet Marneus incurred a mortal wound from Crixus. Evading the blades of the would-be berserkers, Tacitan held his friend in his arms as he felt the life drain from him, vowing to avenge the death of his master and friend. Though he had perished this day, his legacy would not die here. And so it was that Tacitan eschewed his own name, and assumed his new name, Marneus. Reactivating the Wordbearer's vessel's communication system, Calgar sent a simple message to anyone who would listen. To all who can hear, there are enemies of the Emperor here. Send fire, fire, and retribution. Salvaging explosive traps from the passageways of the cave's entrance, Marneus returned to the altar in order to end the rituals once and for all. Ending the lives of several of his former friends, Marneus, though a capable warrior, for his stature was no match for Crixus' headhunter. Yet as the pawn of the ruinous powers attempted to end the life of Marneus, salvation arrived in the form of an angel. Crixus revved his power axe and charged, its whirring teeth grinding into the power sword of this blue-clad giant. Yet such a disgrace could not hope to match the valor of Sergeant Artra of the Ultramarine 2nd Company, and after the bolt rounds fired from his trusty pistol blasted his torso into red ruin, Marneus' explosives detonated. Dragging the aspirant from the tunnels as they collapsed around them, Marneus watched the blood offering to the shrine drag his former allies into a warp portal before being buried under the rubble. Marneus had survived. Breathless and reeling from the encounter, the boy stated he wished to continue his training to Sergeant Artra, the angel simply stating, "An aspirant of quality should be back on his feet by now." Returning to Novafulium to relay the news of the death of his noble lord, Marneus continued his trials to become an angel of death. Surviving grueling tests of willpower, constitution, and strength, though inducted as part of 300 aspirants, only one would survive. Unwilling to allow his lord's name to be denied its rightful place amongst the ranks of the Ultramarines, no hardship would be too difficult for the bearer of his title to endure. Proven worthy of the transformation to become a Space Marine, Marneus never faltered in his service to his chapter, whether among the ranks of the 10th Scout Company, secondment to the Death Watch, or captaincy of his own battle company. Fearless in his methods of waging war, as he charged at the spear tip of every engagement, tales of Calgar's undaunted assaults and tactical brilliance filled 28 volumes of records housed within the vaults of the Fortress of Hera. Achieving glories twice-fold of even the most storied Space Marine of the chapter, only the deeds of their genesire Rebute Gilliman exceeded those of this paragon of the 13th. With centuries of service made in the name of his chapter, there was no question to whom would lead the chapter with the death of his predecessor. Once instated as Chapter Master of the Ultramarines, Calgar donned the Artificer Terminator power armor suit, the Armor of Antilochus, crafted by the tech priests of Adimax Primus. Wielding the gauntlets of Ultramar, these immense mastercrafted power fists, fitted with bolters, crushed and pulverized the enemies of the Imperium into red mist. Said to have been salvaged from a slain champion of chaos by Rebute Gilliman himself during the Gamalia Reclusium massacre, none save for the Primarch have ever dismantled its impenetrable armor casings to investigate the workings within. Adorned in battle honors and artifact devices befitting his station, the iron halo upon his back and relic blade at his hip guard the Lord of Macragge from all danger. Taking to the field upon his ancient land raider, replete with purity seals and immaculate gold and marble fixtures, Maximus, the terrifying sight of the hulking master of the Ultramarines charging into the thick of battle, is a sight to behold. Already having served his chapter for centuries of service, though many heroic deeds would be tallied during his tenure, among the greatest of note occurred during 754.M41. A new threat to the galaxy had begun, its acts of devastation in earnest, and in the ensuing millennia has proven to be among the greatest threats to life itself, the Tyranids. Invading Ultramar from the galactic eastern fringe, High Fleet Behemoth presented a threat on a scale not seen to the survival of Ultramar since the dark days of the Horus Heresy. Never had a chapter master of the Ultramarines faced such a calamitous foe in the heart of the indomitable Empire of Ultramar. Yet here Marneus stood, defiant against an onslaught of devouring abominations. Rallying the vast fleet of Ultramar to defend Macragge, though many planets of their fiefdom had already fed the great devourer's insatiable hunger, their chapter's homeworld could never be allowed to fall. Within weeks, hundreds of vast bioships swept across the Ultramar system, slaughtering millions in their wake as they headed straight for Macragge. Spilling forth their hordes of rabid beasts upon Macragge, the Tyranids proved too immense a foe to combat head-on with such uneven numbers. Forming three armies to oppose the Great Devourer, Calgar appointed the 1st and 2nd to garrison each of the palace's polar fortresses, whilst he led the 3rd in their attempts to slow the Tyranids' advance. Upon Cold Steel Ridge, every weapon, strategy, and lure was employed to thin the numbers of the Xenos into narrow kill zones. Waves of tactical, assault, armored and scout contingents outflanked and corralled the aliens into ambushes, yet no matter how high the kill toll rose, more of these verminous species reinforced their number. Encountering the first ever Swarm Lord recorded by Imperial records, this gigantic monstrosity broke the Ultramarines' lines and forced Calgar to order a full-scale retreat. This hive tyrant was cunning, and knowing its prey to be escaping, charged headfirst into the path of Marneus Calgar. Standing his ground, Calgar bought time for his men to escape, his body rent and torn apart by the Swarm Lord during the battle. Hurling themselves between their master and the hive tyrant, Marneus's honor guard endangered their own lives in order to retrieve his body. The sacrifice of Brother Aloysius, allowing for the escape of the Lord of Macragge aboard a Thunderhawk gunship, this deadly foe had proven to be a brutal and tenacious foe. Treating the Chapter Master's injuries as best they could, the apothecaries and tech marines of the Ultramarines hastened their ministrations to allow Calgar to return to the field. Within mere hours, Marneus returned to the battlefield, his injuries still fresh, but treated enough to enable his body to function. Pressing the attack at the vanguard of his men, Calgar combated the fleet in orbit, whilst his Ultramarines First Company fended off the Tyranids on the surface of Macragge. Reinforcements of Battlefleet Backer answered the summons from Calgar, and with the might of the Imperial Navy by his side, the battle continued. Knowing their forces to be outnumbered by margins incapable of victory, Lord Admiral Rath ordered his own Emperor-class flagship, the Dominus Astra, to charge into the heart of the High Fleet. Detonating his vessel's warp drive, the valor and sacrifice of these mortal men of the Navis Imperialis destroyed the Tyranid fleet by dragging their forms into oblivion. Escaping the blast radius, Calgar's men returned to the surface of Macragge to mop up the remaining presence of Xenos. Aiding the Third Company in their purge of the unclean, such was their valor during the battle that they would earn the company the moniker of Scourge of Xenos with the conclusion of this campaign. The battle was over. The elite First Company, the Warriors of Ultramar, had died to a man. Debris littered the orbit of Macragge, and its surface was piled high with both human and Xenos dead. Yet despite such hardships, the Ultramarines had achieved victory. Honoring the fallen with towering statues commemorating their sacrifice, the names of every stalwart hero of this battle would be recounted each and every feast of days. It would take decades, perhaps centuries, for the chapter to recover from this ordeal. Yet Marneus Calgar refused to allow the legacy of his kin to be destroyed. They were the first to suffer at the fangs and talons of the Great Devourer, and they would not be the last. Yet more than any, the Ultramarines had tested the measure of their foe and would form elite bands of Tyrannic War veterans. These warriors were a cut above any Astartes of the Imperium, for they now carried the solemn yet proud duty to comprise the new First Company of the Ultramarines. For new threats burgeoned without end across the galaxy, and it would not be long before the Great Devourer harried the chapter once more. Fully healed from his injuries incurred from the First Tyrannic War, Calgar continued to lead his chapter with distinction. Banishing the demonic infestation of the Forge World of Frax during 762.M41, breaking the siege of Zalafras of 797.M41, and committing the entirety of the chapter to combat the Eldar Xenos during the Battle of Orar's Sepulchre, no heretic nor alien could besmirch the honor of the Ultramarines and be allowed to live. For many years, Marneus oversaw heroes of his kinsmen perish, only for promising scions to continue their legacy. Heroes such as Severus Agaman of the First, Cato Sicarius of the Second, Mikhail Fabian of the Third, and Uriel Ventris of the Fourth had all proven themselves worthy inheritors of their battle company's pedigree. Called to defend their homeworld once more, every Astartes of the chapter braced for the invasion of Ultramar during 997.M41. The events prior to the invasion begin with Makar the Reborn. Leading his piratical fleet to attack the heart of Ultramar during 878.M41, the Knight Champion Cato Sicarius had thwarted the efforts of the Thrice-born within the Helimar Rift, allowing its escape into the warp, stalling his inevitable return to the material realm. Seizing the Starfort, Indomitable, with his return during 935.M41, Makar's hatred for the Imperium dating back to his days as a Dark Apostle of the Wordbearer's Legion during the Horus Heresy stoked his disdain for the 13th. Battling Marneus within the Indomitable, Calgar knew that such a creature, if slain, would only return again to harry his chapter once more. Defeating the Demon Prince in single combat, Marneus and his allies imprisoned the demon within the warp core of the Starfort to contain its malevolent power. Garrisoning the Indomitable with members of the Ultramarines 5th Company, the Wardens of the Eastern Fringe, to prevent his escape. Such a decision would have to suffice until a permanent means to destroy the demon presented itself. For 62 years, the Demon Prince bided its time, until an unlikely ally to its cause freed it from bondage. Honsu, Warsmith of the Iron Warriors, sought to earn vengeance against the captain of the Defender of Ultramar, Uriel Ventress, and should he ally himself with Makar the Reborn, an army of demons would suffice in reinforcing his invasion of Ultramar. Hoping to destroy the Ultramarines and their empire, the half-breed of the Fourth harried the forces of Macragge and its fiefdoms. Defeated by Uriel Ventress within the tomb of the legendary hero of Kalf, Remus Ventanus, with the Fourth Captain's retrieval of the ancient relic within the tomb, once known as the Shard of Erebus, this Athame dagger was a fitting means to banish the Thriceborn. Imparted with the true name of Makar by the revenant of Remus Ventanus, Ventress ventured to the world of Talasar, wherein Marneus Calgar fought the Demon Prince once more. Now possessing the form of the fallen, venerable Ultramarines dreadnought, Altarion, the imposing form of the Thriceborn regardless proved no match for the Lord of Macragge. With the intervention of Uriel, the Fourth Captain declared the true name of the demonic prince and hurled the Athame dagger to his chapter master. Plunging the Athame, which the Ultramarines guarded as the Blade of Ventanus, into the form of Makar, combined with the proclamation of its true name, the demon suffered its final death, never to be reborn again. Ultramar had been saved once more, yet the era of the Dark Imperium is nothing but merciless, and it would only be 2 solar years before its domain was once again imperiled. The calendar of 999.M41 is among the darkest and most devastating years in the Imperium's long history. Abaddon the Despoiler, Warmaster of Chaos and champion of the Ruinous Powers, had launched his infamous 13th Black Crusade, the result of which had destroyed the fortress world of Cadia and torn the galaxy in twain. The Cicatrix Maledictum, or Great Rift, had spread across the stars, and with its birth cascaded into numerous chaos incursions, psychic awakenings, and portents of ill omens. Reeling from the invasion of Makar and his bloodborne band of heretics, the Ultramarines braced themselves against the onslaught of the Black Legion. Emboldened from their victory at Cadia, Abaddon's forces laid claim to Ultramar, their objective to slay the dormant Primarch of the 13th. The Celestinian Crusade had escaped Cadia, and with Belisarius Call and the Eldar Inari in tow, raced to Macragge. This moment, whatever its outcome, would be a linchpin to the long war, for should the comatose Primarch fall, Chaos's dominion would be all but assured. As the Ultramarines fought with every resource available to defend the Temple of Hera, including aid from the enigmatic chamber militant of the Ordo Malleus, the Grey Knights, Marneus received word of the arrival of the Celestinians. Archmagos Belisarius Call beseeched Chapter Master Calgar to minister to the body of Rebute Gilliman, for he bore a suit of armor, painstakingly crafted for 10,000 years, made to sustain his life. Alongside the ancient tech priest stood Ivrain, leader of the Eldar band of warriors known as the Inari, offering a means to resurrect the son of the Emperor through arcane Xenos arts. Uneasy with the prospect of working alongside the Eldar, despite his misgivings, Marneus knew in his heart that should a chance to revive his Primarch be possible, it must be taken, despite the advisements of his lieutenant, First Captain Severus Agaman. Buying time for Ivrain and Belisarius to attend to the Primarch, Marneus led his forces to combat the Black Legion's invasion of the Fortress of Hera. Traitor Space Marines swarmed the shrine of the Primarch, Calgar's armor cracking and his face beaten bloody in the rabid melee. Then, they locked eyes. Rebute Gilliman stood, looking down upon his unknown son before marching into the fray and unleashing his long-restrained fury. Carnage ensued as the Avenging Son slew traitors with mere swats of his fists, each blow capable of destroying their forms in arcing swathes of unimaginable strength. The battle was won the moment the Lord of Ultramar had stirred, and with his Ultramarines driven by pure, righteous amazement at the sight of their returned liege, none could stay their wrath. Severely wounded, Marneus Calgar met with his Primarch following the battle within the temple. As the shadow of his imposing and magnificent liege cast over him, Rebute Gilliman looked with kindness to the custodian of his legacy and humbly requested to assume command from the Chapter Master. Such a gesture was not needed, for it was Gilliman's right to do as he pleased within his domain, yet such is the character of this noble son of the Emperor that upon hearing his request, Marneus Calgar knelt before his gene father and surrendered his sovereignty of the chapter in perpetuity. Driving back the Black Legion from the realm of Ultramar, none could hope to match the tactical acumen of a Primarch, let alone the single greatest logistician to ever grace existence. Though Calgar's strategies had been superhuman, Gilliman's were near deific, and it would not be long before Ultramar was cleansed of traitor filth. Formally coronating Gilliman as the returned Lord of Ultramar, Marneus, First Captain Severus Agaman, Chief Librarian Tigurius, the Celestinians, Grey Knights, and a representative of every Ultramarines company looked in awe at the visage of their resurgent Lord. Calgar had relinquished his command of the chapter, yet none could diminish his prestige. And so it was that Marneus Calgar retained his title as the Lord of Macragge and was installed as his Primarch's most trusted advisor. Purging the taint of chaos from Macragge and its fiefdoms after several months of combat, Gilliman announced his mission to venture to Holy Terra in order to convene with his father, the Emperor, for guidance. Tasking Marneus with the continued campaigns to reclaim Ultramar from the remnants of its invaders, though the first, second, and third battle companies must venture with Gilliman to the throne world, the remaining Ultramarines companies cleanse their kingdom of heretics. Though the title of Master of Ultramar would return to its true bearer, Marneus was honored with the moniker of Lord Defender of Greater Ultramar and continued his duty to defend his realm from invasion. Gilliman had succeeded in his venture to Terra, and following his audience with the Emperor, secured a new army of warriors to reclaim the stars, the Primaris Space Marines. Developed in secret by Archmagos Belisarius Kall, these superior variants of the Astartes would prove invaluable in combating the burgeoning forces of chaos. Knowing this catalyst in Imperial history to be too great to ignore, the grandfather of decay and pestilence, Nurgle, commanded his champions to invade Ultramar. The Death Guard, led by the demon Primarch Mortarion, unleashed plagues and ruination upon the many worlds of Ultramar. Dispatching Uriel Ventress to locate the Primarch and inform him of the devastation unfolding, Marneus held back the tide of darkness. Rebute Gilliman returned to his fiefdom to find the rot setting deep within its core, his Primaris Space Marines casting back the tide as the firstborn Marines struggled to match their pedigree. Marneus must become stronger, yet no firstborn Space Marines had succeeded in crossing the Rubicon Primaris, a fact that Calgar would change. Surgically implanted with the organs of the Magnificat, Belisarian furnace, and sinew coils by the hand of Belisarius Kall himself, despite projections showing a 61.6% chance of failure, Marneus had always been one to defy the odds. Imbued with newfound strength wrought from the genius of the Archmagos Dominus, Calgar, though having been clinically dead for 20 minutes upon the surgeon's table, was reborn stronger than ever. Too large to fit into his trusty armor, Marneus donned the armor of Heracles, derived from a suit of Mark VIII Gravis armor, tended to by the finest tech savants and artificers. Driving back the Death Guard Legion at the side of his Primarch, Marneus looked upon his kin with pride as they began to successfully join him in crossing the Rubicon Primaris. The Ultramarines had grown mightier, and with Marneus committing his forces to combat the Orcs, Gene Stealers, Eldar and Chaos Pawns upon the world of Vigilus, the War of Nightmares further tests the Lord of Macragge to his limits. Yet there are few legendary figures more revered than Marneus Calgar, and such campaigns could not be in safer, nor more deadly, hands.
You all heard Vero's words. The demon is vulnerable, exposed, and we have one chance to end this. Right here and right now. The fate of Ultramar is in our hands. You are the best and bravest of your chapter. And though we may die in these mountains, we will die in service to something greater than blood, something greater than land. We fight for what we know is right. I will lead you in that fight. And all I ask is that you fight like the heroes you are.
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Marneus of House Calgar has been dead for centuries of war, yet his legacy continues thanks to the loyalty and love of a trusted friend. Marneus never sought to lead his chapter, nor dared to dream to one day see his gene sire return. Yet his deeds made in the service of Ultramar have been rewarded greatly. None can know the conclusion of the story that each of us leave behind, for the plans of mortals often tread paths never intended nor expected to be walked. So look to the future and know that much is beyond your control. For all that you can do is trust in your intentions and keep a close eye on the horizons you strive for.